There's a 9-year-old boy named Joey. He was asked by his mom after he got home from church on Sunday what he learned in Sunday school. How many know Sunday school is important? Learn stuff there. He said, "Well, Mom, our teacher told us how God sent Moses behind enemy lines on a rescue mission to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. When he got to the Red Sea, he had his army build a pontoon bridge so all the people walked across safely. Then he radioed headquarters for reinforcements, and they sent bombers to blow the bridge up, and all the Israelites were saved, and the Egyptians were crossing at that time, and they were drowned in the sea." His mother said, "Now, Joey, is that really what your teacher taught you?" He said, "Well, no, Mom, but if I told you what the teacher actually said, you'd never believe it." That's actually how the world looks at the Bible today. If I actually tell you what happened, you wouldn't believe it. That's what the world says. That's what people that don't want to believe in God say. But how many know the Word is true? The Word is real. For the past couple of weeks, I've been preaching about the faith that we need. How many know it's important to have faith? We looked at what faith is, what faith accomplishes. And the first message I preached, we began by looking at what faith can do. And so as we talked about what faith can do, it shows us that it gives us access to the promises of God, the blessings of God, and through faith we can pray and receive answers and come to know God even more importantly. Last week I preached on another message called "Everybody Needs a Little KFC." And by KFC it means keeping faith in Christ. And how many know it's important that you got to keep your faith in Jesus? Because there are times when things in life will test your faith, will come against your faith, and everything in life is going to say it ain't real, but you've got to hold on and persevere during those times. You've got to keep the faith in Christ. Jesus said that you have to have faith, and without faith, it's not going to work that much. You got to believe God and trust in Him. And I love that song that says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good." So how many know that type of faith is finger-licking good? Amen. So you got to have faith in Christ. Well, this morning I'm going to preach about the story in which Jesus feeds 4,000 people plus women and children with just 7 loaves of bread and a couple little fish. And as I preach on this, I'm going to ask this question. What kind of faith do you have? Because that's what comes out in this passage of Scripture to me as I was studying and praying over what to deliver from this. What type of faith do you have this morning? Do you have the kindergarten faith like we saw in the video earlier, or do we have the faith that really counts and what we really need? Let's start with Matthew 15, beginning on verse 32. It says, "Now Jesus called his disciples to himself and said, 'I have compassion on the multitude because they have now continued with me 3 days and have had nothing to eat.'" Now stop, let's pause right there. Do you understand what he just said? These people have been having church for 3 straight days. They hadn't got anything to eat. You're talking about a long revival. Long-winded preacher. 3 straight days, Jesus is teaching and preaching. They haven't gone anywhere. They have sat there, slept there. I don't know where they went to the potty, but they were there for 3 days as Jesus taught, healed, and did what he did. And so at the end of those 3 days, he's concerned about them. And he goes on and says, "I do not want to send them away hungry, lest they faint on the way." Verse 33, "Then his disciples said to him, 'Where could we get enough bread in the wilderness to fill such a great multitude?' Jesus said to them, 'How many loaves do you have?' And they said, 7 and a few little fish. So he commanded the multitude to sit down on the ground, and he took 7 loaves and the fish and gave thanks, broke them, gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave to the multitude. So they all ate and were filled." Look at your neighbor and say, "Got filled." Got filled, got plenty of KFC there. "And they took up 7 large baskets full of fragments that were left." Verse 38, "Now those who ate were 4,000 men besides women and children. And he sent away the multitude, got into the boat, and came to the region of Magdala." Now look at chapter 16. "Then the Pharisees and the Sadducees came, testing him, asking him if he would show them a sign from heaven. And he answered and said to them, 'When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And he left them and departed. Now, when his disciples had come to the other side, they'd forgotten to take bread. Trouble's coming. They forgot to take food. That'd be like y'all showing up tonight and the pastor forgot to go to KFC. Like I promised I would. Then Jesus said to them, "Take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees." And they reasoned among themselves, saying, "It is because we have taken no bread." And Jesus was aware of it. And he said to them, "O you of little faith, why do you reason among yourselves because you have brought no bread? Do you not understand or remember the 5 loaves and the 5,000 and how many baskets you took up? Now the 7 loaves of the 4,000 and how many large baskets you took up? How is it that you do not understand that I did not speak to you concerning bread, but to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees?" Then they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of the bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. So let's look at this morning. And I want to ask this question: what type of faith do you have? Because as we read these different, seemingly different stories, there's a theme that runs through them, I think, about faith. And it challenges us to ask this question of ourselves: what type of faith do I really have? Because that is critical. How many know that just because you believe is not necessarily enough? Doesn't the Word say that the devils believe in God and they what? They tremble. But is they saved? No. They believe. They know God's real. They are terrified of Him because they have come face to face with the power of God Almighty. They tried to withstand Him, and they realize, you know, He's Almighty. We ain't nothing compared to Him. There is none like the Lord our God. So just believing is not quite enough. There's a difference of faith there. What type of faith do you have? So as we look at this, I've got several different points I want to bring out this morning. First of all, I want to call it this: fishy faith forgets what God has done in the past. You know what I'm talking about, fishy faith? Fishy faith forgets what the Lord has done already. This actually happened in this particular story. In the prior verses, Matthew tells us that Jesus had went up on a mountainside where a large crowd gathered, and he spent their days there healing and teaching and doing the ministry that he was doing there. And after 3 days of ministry, Jesus didn't want to send the crowd away hungry because they hadn't eaten for 3 days. They've been having a revival service, you know, for 3 straight days. How many of y'all remember the days back when you had revivals that went on for 1 and 2 weeks? I mean, maybe not 24 hours a day, but you know what? You know, the Spirit began to move, and it just extended that thing and extended that thing. And I've read some that went on for months, and, you know, it was just you. People were hungry for God. Nowadays, if it ain't over in 35 minutes, you know, people start checking out, you know. So, you know, where's our hunger for God? So these people stayed there, and Jesus, out of compassion for them, he realizes that they need to be fed. So he challenges his disciples and asks them a question. What do we got to feed them? And they respond with this, you know, mind-blowing statement: where in the world are we going to go get enough food out here to feed all this crowd? It's almost like they totally forgot just earlier that Jesus had multiplied a few fish and a few loaves of bread that they had again and fed even more people than were present at that point. He had fed 5,000 plus men, women, and children. So that prior crowd could have been as many as 15, 20, 30,000 because they had lots of kids back then. All right, so you get that picture. And yet there's a smaller crowd at this point, and they totally forget the prior miracle. That's why I say this morning, fishy faith forgets sometimes what God has done in the past. You know, not too long ago, you know, one of our seniors, and I won't say who because I don't want to embarrass him, one of our seniors that loves to play golf, but it got to a point where he just couldn't see where the ball was going after he hit it. So somebody at the golf course suggested that he teams up with another gentleman, an elderly guy from our church that happened to play at that course. And so, you know, he said, you know, he's got the eyes of an eagle, of a hawk, and I think you guys will do well together. So they partnered up. The golfer took that advice of the guy, and they went out golfing together. And so he swung at that first drive, and it was a beautiful drive. I mean, it just went, I mean, it was just right down the center lane, just going straight. I mean, it was just going for a long period of, you know, it was just awesome. So he asked his new partner, he said, "Well, did you see where it went?" And he said, "Sure did. I just can't remember where I saw it go." That's the problem with some people sometimes. We see things that God has done, but because we're looking at it with our natural mind and our natural eyes, we see sometimes, but we don't see. I have seen people literally see a literal miracle right in front of them and still don't believe it. Why? Because, you know, that old phrase, seeing is believing, that ain't necessarily true, honey. I've seen people see things and still not believe. But even those who do believe, if we're not careful, if we have what I call fishy faith, you'll forget what you've already seen and experienced of God, and so that the next time you need that, you don't believe it anymore. You're not, it's not even registering anymore. How many know that you've got to overcome that and not have this fishy type of faith? Their current circumstance and crisis caused them to forget what God had already done even more than what they needed for their present time. How many know that what God does in the past should be like a building block, a stepping stone to the next level? So that if you see God do this, then you should be able to believe him to do this. And when you see God do this, you should be able to believe to see him to do this. It should be a stepping stone to get you higher and higher to believe God for more, but yet the disciples were going downward in the opposite direction. They had, at this point, I want to call it just fishy faith. You see, we'd have to have a faith in God that is strong and growing. Can you say amen to that? We've got to have faith that's strong in the Lord and that grows and develops, because fishy faith forgets what God has done in the past so that you can't claim what you need for your present and for the now points inside of our lives. If we sit around chewing on molded bread from fishy faith that stinks, why do that when you can believe God for some filet mignon and an Idaho potato and gourmet coffee to drink? You got your choice. See, we need to have a faith that's strong and growing, that believes God. To avoid having fishy faith, you know what you got to do? You got to do what Paul says in Romans chapter 10, verse 17. He said, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You've got to stay in God's word. You need more than just what your pastor preaches on a Sunday morning. You need to get in God's word every day. Spend time reading the word, studying the word, praying the word, singing the word of God. You need to put the word in you, and so that the word fills you, and that's how your faith begins to grow, because the word of God feeds, I believe, faith. It enables us to trust God, to believe God, because you've got God's word in you. There is something powerful about the word of God. It's living, it's alive, it's active, and it will change your life. And it'll help you get rid of the fishy faith so that you have faith that's strong to believe God for what you need. Because how many know, honey, when the rubber hits the road and you're in your middle of your crisis, you may not always get to be able to call Brother James over here on the hotline. Thank God for the prayer chain that you can do that. But you know what? Sometimes he might be busy. And you know what you're going to have to do? You're going to have to learn to pray a prayer of faith on your own. Sometimes you just got to learn to stand strong and to pray and to believe God for the promises of God. And thank God we have other brothers and sisters in Christ that will stand with us and support us when we're weak. But there was a time in David's life when there was nobody there with him. And so the Bible says David encouraged himself in the Lord. He realized, I'm going to die here. I ain't got nobody to help me here except Jesus or God at that point. And so he just does the only thing. He encourages himself in the Lord. And we know David is the psalmist. And I believe he began to sing praise songs unto God, and as he sang praise songs, I believe the anointing of God's spirit began to stir within inside of him, and he began to release his faith, and he began to trust in God, and God honored that and preserved and brought him eventually to be the king of Israel. How many know you got to get rid of that fishy faith? Can you say amen to that this morning? Well, there's a second type of faith I want to talk about for a few seconds, and that's this: fickle faith fails to believe what God can do now. It's a little bit different than fishy faith. I call it fickle faith. St. Augustine said this. He lived back in the 3rd and 4th century. He said, faith is to believe what we do not see, and the reward of faith is to see what we believe. Let me say that again. Augustine said, faith is to believe what we do not see, and the reward of this faith is to see what we believe in. That's an awesome statement there. See, we got to have faith that is not fickle. What is fickle faith? Well, fishy faith that the disciples had, it caused them to be fickle. What I mean by fickle? By fickle, I mean unreliable, prone to let you down. You've been around somebody or something that's fickle? They're prone to let you down. They're unreliable. You just don't know whether you can trust them or not. They're going to come through. That's an awful place to be in when you got fickleness about you. Fishy faith will produce that fickleness inside of us that becomes an unreliable source. You would think after seeing Jesus feed the 5,000 plus with just the same few little loaves and of bread and a few little fishes, that they could have then believed God for the great crowd that was before them that was still smaller, but yet they couldn't. They should have been great men of faith at that point, but no, no. Instead, they missed the boat again. Matter of fact, their response in verse 33 tells us that when they said, well, where do you expect us to go out here and get enough food to feed all this crowd? It tells me that their faith was fickle. It just wasn't working right. You know, they were thinking they needed to make a run to Costco or Sam's, but you know what? All they needed was faith in the great I Am. Faith in the great I Am. The one who created all things, who upholds all things. How many know that if God created it, he can fix it? If God started it, he can intervene at any point. That's the God that we serve. So we've got to have faith that's not fickle. I read once in Mark Batterson's book, In a Pit with a Lion on a Snowy Day. I encourage you to get that book. It's a powerful little book. He said, too often our prayers revolve around asking God to reduce the odds in our lives. We want everything to be in our favor. Maybe God wants to stack the odds against us so we can experience a miracle of divine proportions. Maybe faith is trusting God no matter how impossible the odds are. Maybe our impossible situations are opportunities to experience a new dimension of God's glory. That's powerful. We're always praying, Lord, you know, take it away. But maybe God is wanting to let it pour on for a little bit so that it's impossible as far as we're concerned. And that's the point where we have to believe God for a new power, a new dimension of his glory to be manifest, for a miracle that only God can come through with. And how many know that when only God can do it, then only God can get the glory out of the midst of it. So let's believe God. Instead of having fickle faith, let's have faith that is strong during that time. Paul said it this way, maybe this is what we need. We need to be rooted and built up in him, in Christ, and established in a faith, abounding in it with thanksgiving. There's got to be a rootedness inside of us, a faith that is firmly built up in Christ and in the Word of God so that we can abound at that point and be thankful. I've got a little quote here on the PowerPoint I want to go ahead and bring up. I made this. With faith that's fickle, all you're going to get is a sour dill pickle. But when you have faith that's stable, you can sit down and feast on the blessings of God's table. Amen. How many enjoy feasting on the blessings of the table of the Lord? Matter of fact, Psalm 23 says he'll prepare a table for you in the presence of your what? Your enemies. And you can feast and taste and see that the Lord is good and enjoy the blessings of God. Or you can sit around eating a sour dill pickle. I hate sour dill pickles. I know some of you probably like sour dill pickles. I can't stand them. I like the sweet Jergens. I can go to town on a jar of sweet Jergens. You know, I can eat the whole jar if I'm not careful. Them sourdough pickles, ugh. You know, every time they slap them on my burger, you know what I usually end up doing? I forget to tell them to hold the pickles. I go pulling that burger up, getting ketchup and mustard all over my fingers to pull that pickle off. Now, sometimes I'm too lazy and I just eat the pickle anyway, but most of the time it's like, I forgot to tell them to hold the pickles. And you know, get rid of that pickle, sourdough. Why do they do that? Most people don't like them, I think, but maybe I'm just weird. But anyway, how many know that you got to have faith that's not fickle? Turn to somebody and say, don't be fickle. All right, or you'll be a pickle. All right, number three. This is the other one. Fake faith first wants proof before it believes. I see some fake faith going on here in the stories that I read to you out of Matthew's gospel. Fake faith, what does that want? Well, if your faith is fake, you're going to want proof before you're going to believe it. And that's not exactly how God works. And we got to understand that principle. How many of you ever heard of Corrie Ten Boom? Powerful woman of God who, you know, the hiding place during World War II, great woman. She said this, faith sees the invisible, believes the unbelievable, and receives the impossible. I love that. Faith sees that which is invisible. It believes the unbelievable, and it receives the impossible. See, in chapter 16, in the story that I read to you of Matthew, Jesus comes to a point where, you know, he's confronted by the religious leaders of the day, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They come to him demanding that he show them a sign that they can accept who he is and what he's doing to show them that he's from God. Give us another sign. You know, despite the fact that he's then healed the sick, raised the dead, fed thousands with miracles, cast out devils, done everything that no human being could do, and yet they still come to him and say, we want another sign. We want another sign. I mean, they had fake faith. It was not real faith at all. And Jesus rebukes them. He doesn't have time for that foolishness. Jesus just flat out rebukes them and just casts them aside. He criticizes them. He says, it's like you can look at the sky and you can interpret the weather, but you can't see the signs of the times. And he was actually telling them, you should have seen prophetically, I am fulfilling the prophecies that speak of what the Messiah will be, what he will do, and how he will respond. And if you would only to look at the scriptures, they would have seen that Jesus was the one prophesied to come. Matter of fact, Daniel even prophesied the very time period that the Messiah would come if they had read it and interpreted it properly. Because Daniel gave a prophecy in Daniel chapter 9 that actually pinpointed the exact year that the Messiah would come to Israel. They should have known that. They should have saw that. They should have understood that. But they missed the promises of God, the blessings of God, because they refused to accept it. They had faith that was fake. They had fake faith. They were religious, but they were not righteous before God. Matter of fact, Jesus said, the only sign I'm going to give you is the sign of the prophet Jonah. You know what the prophet Jonah was? In Matthew chapter 12 earlier, Jesus referred to this Jonah thing, and he said the sign of Jonah in Matthew chapter 12 was the fact that he spent 3 days in the heart of the earth in the belly of the whale. And he said, and that was a spiritual type of how Christ would die, and he would spend 3 days in the heart of the earth, in the grave, but how many know that he came alive again? And just as that big whale, that fish, whatever that sea creature was, came up finally and spewed Jonah out of his mouth, he came out. That's how Jesus did. He came out of death. Death could not hold Christ. He said, that's the only sign I'm going to give you. And guess what? Sadly, even though Jesus rose from the dead, and even though it was documented and witnessed by even the Roman guards that were guarding the tomb, those Roman guards, if you remember, I preached a few weeks ago, they went running to the Jewish people, the very ones that are criticizing Jesus at this point, told them that he was raised from the dead, told them about the angel, told them all that, and you know what they did? They gave him money and said, instead, let's say that his disciples came and took his body. They tried to cover up the true news with fake news. Matter of fact, going up to the next slide there. Oh, this is it. Some say his disciples stole his body, but you know what? That was fake news. See, that's what the world does. Faith, if it's fake, will always demand proof before it will believe. But real faith believes before it receives. Real faith in God will believe before you actually receive it. Fake faith says that you got to show me some proof here. You know, sometimes out of his mercy, God will give some people some proofs of some things. Yeah, that is biblical. He does that at times. Gideon did that little fleece thing. But you can't force God to do that. God says, no, you trust me. If you can't believe that I am and I created all things, then, this is kind of pointless here. So we've got to have faith that believes God, and then we will receive it. Matter of fact, I've got a quote by Abraham Lincoln. He said this, faith is not believing that God can, but that God, say it with me, will. There's a big difference between the can and the will. Faith is not believing that God can, but it's that God will. We need to have that type of faith this morning. That's why Jesus said in Mark chapter 11, verse 24, therefore I say to you, whatever things soever you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them, you shall have them. There's just something about faith and believing God, taking him at his word, that makes a difference. That somehow activates the promises of God, that somehow connects us to the power of God, that somehow releases things to be happening in our lives, and not only us, but in those that are around us, but it takes faith. Instead, we have this fake faith quite often that says, God, I want you to show me a proof, a sign, give me this, give me that, instead of taking God at his word and saying, Lord, I believe you, even if I don't see it right now, I'm going to believe you, God. I'm going to take you at your word. I want to tell you this. I didn't plan to say this right now, but there are going to be things, Lord willing, if we're around here long enough, that are going to start happening in this world at some point that's going to freak some people out. They're going to throw out the Bible, and they're going to just totally walk away from whatever. Jesus prophesied. Paul spoke of a great falling away that would happen in the last days. Why? Because apparently there are going to be some things starting happening in the earth that's going to make people question everything. Some, I don't know what they are, but the word kind of indicates that there are things that are going to happen that are so terrifying that men's hearts will fail them for fear for the things they see and think are coming upon the earth. A lot of people will walk away from God, but you know what? I don't care what happens in the news. I don't care what you see in the sky. I don't care what goes on around you. You have faith in God and his word. And look up, for your redemption is drawing nigh. That's what Jesus said. When you see whatever happening, you hear whatever happening, you look up because he's coming again for you. You hold your faith in Christ and trust in him because your God cares for you. Your God will come through for you, but you've got to keep your faith in Christ. Don't have a fake faith that just tosses away everything, but instead say, Lord, I believe. Even if people look around you and looking at you and saying, you're nuts, you're crazy, that's stupid, that's foolish. You know what? They're the fools. Because we have the truth. We have the truth. Jesus even once said this. It was a question. He said, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on the earth? You remember reading that? When he returns, when I come, will I find faith? It's almost like, you know, apparently things will progress at some point where there's this question of, will we have? But there really will be people of faith, I believe, at that time. But you know what? He wanted us, I think he said that because he wanted us to examine our faith. Be sure, do we have real faith? Do we have fishy faith? Do we have fickle faith? Or do we have fake faith? Or do we have the real type of faith? There's a fourth point I get out of Acts chapter 16 also, and that's this. It's called faulty faith. Turn to your neighbor and say faulty. Faulty faith jumps to false conclusions. I see some faulty faith going here in this story where people jumped to the wrong conclusion. Have you ever had somebody jump to the wrong conclusion about you? Falsely accuse you of something? Misunderstand what was going on? Didn't hear what was going on? You know, didn't catch that and jumped to a false assumption, a false conclusion? Well, you know what? If you have faith that's a little bit faulty, you'll do that almost every time. And you'll end up where you shouldn't be. After all these wonderful miracles and healings and demonstrations of Jesus showing the faith that we really need, we see his disciples still messing up again in chapter 16. Still messing up. Even after he feeds 4,000 people, they still miss the boat. They still mess up with this. Jesus has put the Sadducees and the Pharisees in their place, and he kind of took his disciples on a little further, and he decides to, you know, do a little teaching time with them, and he cautions them. He says, beware of the leaven of the scribes and the Pharisees or Sadducees. Beware of their leaven. They misunderstood what Jesus was saying. They thought he was a little ticked off because they had forgotten to take lunch. Apparently somebody was supposed to go to KFC and bring along a big bucket of chicken, and somebody didn't do it. Or they actually got it and, God forbid, walked off and left it sitting on the table. Have you ever had a little doggy take-home tray going out to eat? Had it all boxed up, got to talking, or you were so in love with that sweet thing sitting there with you that you just got up and walked off and left your take-home sitting on the table? Done that plenty of times. And then you get halfway home and you realize, I just left my steak. I left my fish, left my whatever. And you know, nowadays when you go out to eat, it ain't cheap. Let's put it that way. And by the time you get back, you know what they've done with it? They've already chucked it in the trash. They've cleaned that table off. You know, so somebody forgot to take lunch. Somebody was supposed to bring bread because it was a long journey, apparently, where they were going. So, you know, I don't know, Jesus maybe had told them that, or common sense, they realized that. But then they realized, we forgot it. Mark's gospel says they only had one loaf. So, you know, everybody else, somebody brought some, but it was not enough to feed 13 people or the crowd that was there. So they thought Jesus was upset. They misinterpreted what he was saying. They thought he was ticked off. They jumped to a false conclusion. Why? Because their faith was faulty. They misunderstood. They misinterpreted that. They jumped to a false conclusion with this, and Jesus has to correct them. And he reminds them, says, oh, you have little faith. You need to get over this. Stop having faith that's so easily messed up. How many know you need to trust in God? And stop jumping to false conclusions. Stop making false assumptions about people. Now, I realize there are some people in this world that are evil, that are malicious, that are just, you ever met some of them people? I mean, they're out to take advantage of you. They'll rip you off. They'll do whatever. So, you know, there are those genuine people, but most people are not. But many times we jump to false conclusions about people because we'll take something that they said out of context, or we'll be offended by this or that they did or that they didn't do, and we'll assign blame to them. This is exactly what the disciples were doing. How many know that you've got to have faith in God and in other people sometimes that goes beyond just that? We've got to have faith that doesn't jump to false conclusions and accusations. People who have a faulty view of God, really it's because it's something that has caused them to be a little warped in the way that they think about God. You know, people who have a faulty faith actually will have an improper view of God, an improper view of other people, and an improper view of themselves. Go into the next PowerPoint slide there. There's a point I want to make out of this. What you believe determines who you are and how you think, act, and feel. That is a biblical principle and a biblical truth that you need to understand. What you believe will determine who you are. And not only that, it will then determine also how you think, how you act, and how you feel. But you know what most of us do? We live by the last thing there, how we feel. And honey, your feelings will deceive you. Even your actions are not always going to be reliable. Why? Because quite often we have screwed up thinking. We're messed up thinking. Our thoughts are not what they need to be. And how many know your thoughts will affect your behavior, and your behavior and your thoughts affect how you feel. And so that's why so many people are so messed up in this world. But that all comes out of this top thing, is because they're not believing the right things. What you believe will change the rest of that. So let me break this down for you. If you believe the right things about God, how many know that'll change your life? But if you don't believe the right things about God, your life is going to be pretty messed up. If you believe that God is some evil tyrant that just wants to squash you like a bug, that hates you, that's out to take all the fun out of life, then that will affect your life. And there are a lot of people that kind of have that mindset about God. And how many know if you believe that type of stuff, it will affect your life and everything else out of that. But if you believe what God says of himself, if you'll take God's word and believe what the Lord says about God, that God is a God of love, that God is a God of mercy and compassion, that God has plans for you to bless and to prosper you. If you will believe those things, and yes, he will deal with sin, he will deal with the bad stuff, but overall, the heart of God is he loves people, he loves you, and if you believe the right things about God, that will change your life. And not only that, but it'll affect every other thing too. Because once you start to believe the right things about God, it'll start changing the way you think. Because how many know the longer you've lived in the world and in sin, you've got some messed up thinking. And so even though your spirit may be saved, your mind still thinks like it shouldn't. And how many know you need to reprogram your mind with the Word of God? And if you reprogram your mind with the Word of God, believing what you should believe, it'll begin to overwrite that stinking thinking, and you'll begin to think rightly. And when you're thinking like you should, how many know that you will start doing like you should? And when you're thinking and doing like you should, then you'll eventually feel what you need to feel. But that also translates into other areas of our lives. Like, for example, if you believe the wrong things about the people that are around you, how many know that will affect your relationships and your ability to interact with them? This principle goes universal. What does 1 Corinthians 13 say about love? Love is patient, love is kind, it believes all things, bears all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Matter of fact, in my own interpretation out of that, love is sometimes a little naive, because love assumes the best, even out of people. And sometimes you can be taken advantage of, but see, that's the risk of love. But if you're going around and you're going to believe that somebody is this or that, then guess what? It's going to predispose you to reject them, to hate them, to not like them, because you're not believing what God says about them. But instead, if you will take God's word, and start saying, Lord, let me have your view of people. Now, understand, there's a balance with this. God knows that people are sinners, and God will convict of sin, and God deals with sin, you know, so don't misunderstand me. But God looks at the person and says, you know what, this is what you can be if you let me change your life. I have a plan for your life. And so when we begin to look at them like God looks at them, instead of seeing those people that are ugly sinners and that this and that, we see them as people that God loves, that Jesus died for, and that God wants to change their lives. How many know that will change the way you're able to interact with people in the world around you, on your job, and even in your family? So we need to start saying, Lord, let me see what you see with them. And then not only about that, but yourself too. There's a lot of people that have got some messed up ways of thinking and ideas about themselves. People that suffer with low self-esteem, people that suffer with high pride issues and arrogance. You see, if you have a proper belief about yourself that comes from the Bible, how many know that will also change yourself even? How many know that the Word says that you shouldn't think too highly of yourself like you ought to think, but to think what? Soberly, meaning have a right, balanced opinion of yourself, understanding what God thinks of you. And yes, He knows we're not perfect, and yes, He will convict us of our sins and work in our hearts, but Christ in you is what? The hope of glory. And this is what Paul once said. He said when he came to this troubled church called the church at Corinth. You ever read about the church at Corinth in the Bible? Read the letter of 1st and 2nd Corinthians. That was one messed up church. If you go actually to read that, everything that Paul teaches and speaks about, that means that church had an issue going on with it. They had everything going on from sexual immorality to people cheating one another, stealing from one another, lying, doing everything under the sun. They had one guy that was committing incest with his father's wife, and the church was condoning it. They had all this stuff going on, and then they had all the gifts of the Spirit. At least they had the gifts of the Spirit, but the problem was they were out of balance with it. They were so out of order that Paul has to correct it. So this church has good things, but it's got all these problems going on with it. And so Paul actually comes to them, and finally he clears all the mess up. He addresses it, but he said this. He says, I don't want to know anything except Christ in you. I want to know the Jesus in you. Yeah, this other stuff we got to deal with, but let's focus on Christ. You see, Jesus is what joins us all together. Amen. You may be different than me, and you may like different things than I like, and you may do different things than I do, but there's one thing that if Jesus is in you that I have in common with you, and that's the fellowship of the Lord. And if Jesus is in you, even though you don't like the same things that I like in other aspects, I can have a fellowship with you and I can love you and pray that God will work around those things. You see, that's what Paul says. I want to know Christ in you. But we have to let go of all this other stuff in order to let God do that. So that's why we've got to believe the right things about God, about other people, and about ourselves. That brings me to Hebrews 12, verse 2. He says that we need to be looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the Father in heaven. Jesus gives us the very faith that we start off with, but how many know that he also perfects that faith and brings it to its conclusion? Why don't you turn to a neighbor and say, God ain't finished with me yet. Remember that old song we used to sing as children? He's still working on me. I say that quite often. I bring that song up. But it's true. He's still working on us. He's the author. He's the beginner and the finisher of our faith. So that even if my faith is faulty at times, because I am not perfect, there are times where my faith kind of gets faulty. How many know that he can fix that faulty faith if I will bring it to him? And the promise of God is I'll live in all of eternity with him. So let me kind of culminate all this before I bring up this last thing. Fishy faith forgets what God's done in the past. So you don't want fishy faith. We don't want to forget what the Lord has done. You got to remember what the Lord has done inside of your life. Fickle faith fails to believe what God can do now. How many know that we've got to have faith that can receive what God wants to do in our lives, in our present lives and circumstances? So I don't want fickle faith. I don't want fake faith that wants and demands proof before it's going to believe. Sometimes you just got to take God's word and stand on it and believe it despite whatever's happening in your world around you. And then finally, I can't have faulty faith that jumps to conclusions. Instead, I've got to have this, and I'm going to close with this. We've got to have faith that is founded and focused on the Word of God. That's what we need. My faith has got to be founded on Christ and the Word of God. It's got to be firmly founded. It's got to be focused on the Word of God. If I'll have faith that, even if it's my faith is small, if I will found that on the Word of God and focus on that, that small faith is all that's necessary to accomplish whatever God has for me to do. It's sufficient. What kind of faith do you have this morning? It's something we need to stop and ask ourselves. What type of faith do I have? Do I have the type of faith that's going to stand through the trials that are coming at me in my life? Do I have the faith that can endure despite what hits me? Do I have the faith that other people that I love that are in my life can also look to and draw strength from? Because sometimes they're weak. Sometimes they need that. Do I have that type of faith that not only is there for me, but can be a source of encouragement and help for them? Now, eventually, they got to come into their own faith, but how many know that you need to have some that affects other people around you? Do I have that type of faith? Or do I have these other types of faith that just aren't going to cut the mustard. I want to encourage you this morning. If you're having some issues with faith, just do what that man did that had the son that brought him to Jesus' disciples, and they couldn't help him. And Jesus turns to him and says, if you believe, all things are possible. And you know what the dad says? I believe. Help my unbelief.